His Royal Highness, Prince Turki Al-Faisal, is the ambassador for the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to the United States. He was born in February in 1945 in Makkah, Saudi Arabia, and began his schooling there, but eventually graduated from the Lawrenceville School in New Jersey and subsequently pursued an undergraduate degree at Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. He is the youngest son of King Faisal and has served as Saudi Arabia's ambassador to the United Kingdom and Ireland and as the Director General of the General Intelligence Directorate in the Kingdom, its Foreign Intelligence Service. He was appointed ambassador to the United States on July 20, 2005 and presented his credentials to Secretary of State Rice in New York in September of 2005. He is engaged in a number of cultural, social, and educational activities. He is one of the founders of the King Faisal Foundation and is chairman of the King Faisal Center for Research and Islamic Studies in Riyadh. The objective of that center is to promote dialogue and understanding between religions. He is also the co-chair of the C100 group, which promotes interfaith dialogue and has been affiliated with the World Economic Forum. We are very, very grateful and very honored to have with us today His Excellency Prince Turki Al-Faisal of Saudi Arabia.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على أفضل المرسلين سيدنا محمد وسيدنا عيسى وسيدنا إبراهيم وسيدنا موسى عليهم الصلاة والسلام. Dr. Rogers, thank you very much for that kind introduction. I would also like to thank Dr. Ringer for hosting me at the Kennedy Center here and Dr. Peterson for inviting me in the first place and for hosting me yesterday when I arrived. It is a pleasure to be here with you, ladies and gentlemen, but it is a daunting sight in front of me to see so many young faces here, and I hope I will live up to expectations. Over the last year, I have traveled to more than 25 of your states and talked with students at numerous colleges and universities. From Kansas State, the University of Chicago, Tufts, Harvard, MIT, Georgetown, and several others. I have been listening to young people and voice their questions and concerns about the relations between the United States and my country. I have long viewed this interaction as the most important aspect of my job as ambassador. I enjoyed listening and sharing distinct viewpoints, and I look forward to answering your questions after I speak. But first, I was asked to talk about the current state and future of Saudi-U.S. relations. If the request were asked of me 5 years ago, or even 3 years ago, I would have had a very different answer. The events of 9/11 placed a heavy burden on our country's relationship, but one we've shouldered admirably. Today, as a result of serious work on both our sides, there are a lot of positive things to say about that relationship. After King Abdullah of Saudi Arabia met with President Bush in April 2005 on an official level, relations between our two countries are stronger today than they have ever been. What is clear is that the terrorists miscalculated in their attempts to drive our nations apart. They only stirred a resolve that has resulted in greater cooperation and coordination between us. And this extends far beyond the war on terror. Indeed, our enduring relations are bound by much more than oil. We have a number of important pillars that support our relationship. Without preference for their order, there are six of them: the war on terrorism, oil, trade, Middle East stability, military cooperation, and long-standing interpersonal relationships shared between the peoples of our two nations, which have, in fact, endured longer than any official relationship between us. These pillars form our foundation. They define our interaction and provide us with concrete reasons why our nations continue to work together successfully. But where do we go from here? How do we continue to improve our relationship? There are still many issues left unresolved, and there are still many sticking points. To address the challenges before us and the challenges ahead, the first thing we have done is to put in place stronger links between our two governments and a framework to better manage the many complex issues we have on our common agenda. The best example of how this is taking shape is the U.S.-Saudi strategic dialogue. This new mechanism is intended to institutionalize relations between our countries. It is meant to overcome inevitable differences and to align our resources and capabilities to a greater extent. The strategic dialogue is progressing through regular meetings between the Saudi Foreign Minister and the U.S. Secretary of State, as well as among working groups from both governments, to work constructively and comprehensively on a continuous basis on a range of issues of importance to both countries. The first meeting of the dialogue occurred during then Crown Prince, now King Abdullah's visit with President Bush last year in Crawford, Texas. Since then, Foreign Minister Saud Al-Faisal and Secretary of State Rice have met twice for the strategic dialogue. The gatherings are open to candid discussion in a collegial atmosphere. There are also meetings of six working groups within the dialogue, which include energy, economic and financial affairs, consular affairs, partnership, education, exchange and human resources, that is all one committee, military affairs and counterterrorism. This framework is an important mechanism that we hope would endure. It has opened unparalleled levels of communication and is turning out to be a key way our nations are recovering obstacles and overcoming real problems. We're also taking other steps to improve our relationship beyond the very highest levels. Another initiative involves improving relations by increasing people-to-people interaction. The Kingdom is encouraging more delegations of officials and business leaders and citizens to come to the United States to share their views and to learn in kind. We have also expanded a scholarship program to send our students to college abroad. Many of our students will be coming to the United States. More than 10,000 are already studying in your universities. They will not only be receiving a world-class education, but they will be forming the next generation of friendships and bonds between Saudis and Americans. They will be the true ambassadors. I would say one priority we currently have is to develop better relations between Saudi Arabia and the United States Congress. My embassy colleagues and I have been meeting with members of Congress continuously for the past year. We have been working to answer their concerns and questions about the Kingdom, and to express to them our concerns and our questions about how we view our relationship with the United States. There are a lot of issues on this level, as your representatives in both houses of Congress are some of our toughest critics. But as the saying goes, it takes two to tango. And here is where we would like to encourage more interaction on your end. We would like to see more American representatives come to the Kingdom. We want them to see our country. We want them to meet our business community. We want them to hear from our citizens, our men, our women, and our children. And I'm confident that if they come to the Kingdom, their outlook will change for the positive. If you came to the Kingdom, you would see a burgeoning society whose citizens are urban and increasingly sophisticated. They do things like you do. They go to university and internet cafes. They travel extensively and they have embraced their Saudi identity. You would also see the modernizing state in which they were raised and which they will soon be full partners. Saudi surgeons are pioneering new techniques to separate conjoined twins and perform organ transplants. Saudi women are opening businesses in new industries every day. They now have ownership stakes in more than 25,000 companies in the kingdom. Last year, the Saudi Stock Exchange set records and is now the largest emerging market in the world. Technology has been integrated into our society and economy and is driving our performance. In the last 5 years, internet usage has grown for more than 1,000%. This is a much different picture than most people in the United States have of Saudi Arabia. It is important for Americans to be aware of the reality. This brings me to my last observation on how we can improve our relationship in the future. I think the type of discourse that exists between the United States and Saudi Arabia needs to evolve and change. We don't mind being criticized. There is a well-known saying in Arabic, "Your true friend is one who tells you the truth, not the one who simply agrees with you." But it is the way in which Americans criticize us, whether it is politicians or public figures or thought leaders, that causes us concern. We often hear political rhetoric instead of constructive commentary. Americans want to see and hear about reform and change in Saudi Arabia, society and political culture. That is on the agenda, ladies and gentlemen. But we're not going to change just because you tell us to. We are changing and performing our society because it is the right thing to do for our people and for our country. And we will do so in our own way, in accordance with our traditions and culture. Constructive comments are more helpful. Statements we hear from the U.S. generally do not have a clear and real understanding of what is going on in the kingdom and appear to be emotionally driven. It is important to remember that your opinions, your thoughts, and your analyses are not just considered by Americans. They are considered by Saudis, too. And if we want to improve the state of our relations, it would behoove us to improve every level of our communication. Our interests are too intertwined. If you look at the problems we are facing today, the war on terrorism, Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, Palestine, Israel, Lebanon, energy security, and the proliferation of weapons of mass destruction, none of these problems can be faced alone. We must work together to find solutions to these challenges. Recently, the situation in the Middle East has become increasingly critical, and we've tried to be clearer and clearer about what needs to be done. This is important because Saudi Arabia and the United States share a long and special relationship, one that is some 70 years old. We have always been forthright with one another. We have been open and honest, and will continue to be. Our relationship today has matured. It was tested by the tragic events of 9/11 and emerged stronger than before. Officials in both countries have recognized the need to put in place effective frameworks to further solidify our relationship. This effort, I'm pleased to report, is proceeding very well. And I'm confident that the future of our relationship will be, God willing, a bright one. But first, we need to act. Ashkurukum shukran jazeelan. Thank you all very much. And barakallahu feekum. And God bless you all. Thank you, please.
We have, at the gracious consent of His Majesty, the opportunity to take questions, and the questions will be moderated by Corey Leonard, the Assistant Director at the Kennedy Center.
How do you do, sir?
Thank you, sir. We have two standing microphones at the front of each aisle. We'd ask you to come forward If you have a question, please state your name and your major and your hometown, and then your question. Start right here.
Your Excellency, my name is Jonathan Stradling. I'd like to start by asking an obvious question. Last night, the President announced a troop surge in Iraq and is planning on deploying 20,000 more troops there. And his opponents have criticized this this obsession with a military solution in Iraq. My question for you is, what is Saudi Arabia's position on the U.S.'s current military policy in Iraq, and what would you like to see the U.S. do in the future in order to come to some sort of solution of the conflict there?
Well, you asked me an obvious question, and I will give you an obvious answer. The kingdom has always maintained that since America came into Iraq uninvited, it should not leave Iraq uninvited. And by that, I mean that there should be coordination between the Iraqi people and the Iraqi government with the American leadership and the American military presence there on how and when and wherewithal of U.S. withdrawal from Iraq. All of us recognize that withdrawal of coalition troops from Iraq is inevitable. It cannot continue as it is today. But it is the manner in which those troops are withdrawn that is of importance to us, not just in Saudi Arabia, but in the whole region. Iraq today is in a state of ferment, and the government that has been appointed since the very successful and, I might say, very admirable way the parliament was elected last year in Iraq needs to be supported in every way it can, not just by the United States and the coalition allies that are operating there, but also by the rest of us in the area. And the kingdom is providing the support that it can to the Iraqi government and the Iraqi people. We have hosted several conferences between Iraqis, whether Sunni and Shia or Kurd and Arab, and we have also urged the Arab League to be more active in promoting reconciliation between Iraqis. And those meetings that took place in the kingdom, the last one was a couple of months ago during the holy month of Ramadan in the holy city of Mecca, where Shia and Sunni clerics met Iraqi ones and came out with a declaration calling for national reconciliation. But it takes action to be realized rather than simply words and rhetoric. And here is the biggest challenge, I think, more for the Iraqi people and the Iraqi government than for any other person. Historically, Iraq has always been an area and a country of inclusiveness. It was always the river valley of the two of the greatest rivers of the world, the Euphrates and the Tigris, where people from everywhere in the area collected and coalesced and came together. Many tribes from the Arabian Peninsula migrated northwards into that valley and settled over the years. People from the east, from India, from Persia, from Afghanistan, and as far away as China came to Iraq and settled and traded and made it their home. From the west, whether it is from Syria, from the lands of Turkey now, from the Egyptian valley also, they came to that valley and settled and so on. So historically speaking, Iraq has been a very inclusive country. And it is now, we're looking at a very irrational and very bizarre condition in Iraq, where we see that inclusivity turning into exclusive, where a sect is fighting another sect, where an ethnicity is fighting another ethnicity. That is not the normal state of affairs in Iraq. So this is the big challenge for the Iraqi people, and we in the kingdom will do whatever we can to support them in that effort. And as far as the President's speech last night is concerned, it further makes a commitment to staying on in Iraq and discussing with the Iraqis, as he mentioned, his talks with Prime Minister Maliki and the Iraqi leadership on how to go on with this new influx of American troops in Iraq. But the necessary solution to the problems of Iraq has to be political. And the military can be in support of the political solution, not be the exclusive aim of the solution. And it is here, again, where the biggest challenge lies, is how to make a political solution work in Iraq. And it's a very bedeviling issue. I know there are several Iraqi, not just several, but I think most Iraqi people want to reach a political solution. But it is the situation and the breakdown of the social and political fabric of Iraq after the toppling of the Saddam regime that has led to this situation where it is today. And we in the kingdom, as I said, are working closely with Iraqi factions, whether they be Sunni, Shia, Kurd, Turkoman, Yazidi, you name it, and they have it in Iraq. And we're working with all of them to try to bring them together. But it's a tough challenge, and it is something I think that not only the President, but the rest of us have to recognize that for America to back up now and leave is going to be a very detrimental proposition and something that is unacceptable in our part of the world.
My question to you tonight is, as you know, the U.S. 9/11 Commission recommended that the U.S. take major steps to mend its image in the Muslim world. In your opinion, what are one or two crucial steps that the U.S. must take to mend its image in the Arab world? What are the deal breakers?
I wish I could say that there are deal breakers in such an issue. But let's not forget, it's not only the United States that needs to mend its image in our part of the world. I think we, as well as Arab countries and Muslims throughout the world, that we have to mend our image for the rest of the world community. So it's what I call for in my talk, that there is no one solution and no single person or country that can solve these problems. Obviously, as far as the United States is concerned in our part of the world, most of the criticism directed at the United States from the majority of people in our part of the world is towards the policies of the United States, whether it is in Palestine, whether it was in Iraq after the toppling of Saddam Hussein, or in other areas of the Muslim world, in Afghanistan and in other places. So a change in policies has to be taken into account. And in the President's speech last night, as you all heard, he not only concerned himself with the situation in Iraq, but he also said that Secretary Rice, in her coming trip on this Friday to our part of the world, is going to deal with the Middle East, the broader Middle East problem. And I think that is where a very key issue needs to be resolved, and resolved as quickly as possible, which is the Palestinian issue. Many of you in the United States perhaps don't recognize or don't realize that that issue is truly, has become part, if you like, of our genetic structure in the Arab world. I know there's a lot of genetic research that goes on here in Brigham Young and other universities in Utah. But if you dissect the genes of Arabs in general and Muslims, I'm sure you will find a tiny particle there that says Palestine. I'm an example of that. I was born in 1945. The Palestinian problem preceded that, but it came to conflict in 1947, 48, 49. So I was in my very early years. And as a four-year-old, I remember I was in Cairo with my mother and other brothers and sisters. And we experienced our first air raid that took place at that time. And I remember my mother hurrying us to hide us under a table, a huge table that supposedly would have protected us from the bombing. It shows you how much she knew about that kind of thing. But it is from early on in our lives that the issue of Palestine has affected us. And if you look at the subsequent generations of Arabs and Muslims, the consistent issue of Palestine and the repetition of the suffering and the destruction. And all of us recognize today, particularly in the Arab world, that suffering and destruction is not exclusive to the Palestinians. The Israelis too have suffered. Israeli innocents have been killed and their blood was shed and so on. So for the sake of the innocents on both sides, the United States must put in practice what it has expressed in words, which is President Bush's roadmap for peace in the Middle East. That framework for peace is clear to everybody. And even the substance of the peace as envisioned in the Abdullah Peace Plan, which is Israeli withdrawal from Arab territory, including Jerusalem, for full withdrawal from these territories in return for full recognition from all of the Arab countries. So we in the Arab world have made that jump across the chasm. We no longer think as countries and as a majority of our people of driving the Israelis to the sea. They will remain within our communities, those who do think in those terms. But there are within the Israeli community as well those who think that they should drive all the Palestinians out of the what they call the Holy Land for the Jews. So on both sides, there is recognition that we must reach some kind of accommodation along the 67 border lines. And Ehud Olmert now is talking about compromise. Mahmoud Abbas is talking about a compromise. All the leadership in the area is talking about a compromise. All the Arab countries are committed to the Abdullah Peace Plan. And so, with a little pressure from the United States, which is the truly big and very forceful and very huge bear that can push us all towards compromise, we can reach substantial progress in this effort. And I just hope that the President's words about Condoleezza Rice looking at this issue will finally get us to implement what has been so much talked about and in the past.
With the globalization of our modern society, how do you see the effect of the West in Saudi Arabia? What do you think are the results of that? Is it causing like a polarization, or is it causing more of an adaption?
It's both. There will always be within society those who think that the past is better than the future, that preserving and guarding heritage and culture and accepted norms is worth protecting and sometimes even dying for. And they wouldn't want to change things under any circumstances. But I think you will find that not just in Saudi Arabia, but throughout the Arab and Muslim world, the vast majority of people want to move forward. They want to share in the benefits of the globalization. And despite the detractors of globalization, I think there are many benefits to globalization. When you take issues like education, for example, as I mentioned in my talk, and taking the kingdom by itself, not considering other Arab and Muslim countries, getting the skills and the know-how to meet the challenges of today's world cannot be exclusively found in Saudi Arabia. You have to go and search for these things. You have to come to Brigham Young University, you have to go to Berkeley, you have to go to Harvard, you have to go to the University of Beijing, you have to go to Singapore, you have to go to New Delhi. It is that kind of global outlook and global reach that issues like education, like healthcare, like providing nutrition, all of these things are beneficial aspects of globalization, where people can benefit from what is accomplished in other parts of the world. And the kingdom definitely is affected by American values and American culture and American ideas, as we hope the U.S. is affected by Saudi culture and ideas and values and so on. Your country is a country of many nations. Who can define for me what an American is? Two of my friends here are American, Robert Andrews from Georgetown. He's U.S. American. But next to him is Gustavo de los Reyes. He is a Cuban Venezuelan American. And if you go right down the line, I'm sure if I can find out, many of you sitting here come from different backgrounds and different nationalities and different ethnicities. And this is the effect of, or one of the effects of globalization. And Islam in general, when it first came out and expanded throughout the world, practiced globalization. The word for check in English comes from the Arabic word sak, which means contract or deed. And it used to be issued in the height of Arab and Muslim civilization. A deed would be issued in Cordoba and would be honored in Peking. It was that kind of practice that the Arab and Muslim civilization not only enjoyed, but were very prominent in. So globalization does affect Saudi Arabia, and it affects every country in the world. The negative aspects of globalization, of course, are unacceptable. But that is why you have things like the World Trade Organization, where people can go and sit down and discuss infringements on accepted norms, or the United Nations, if you like, where political issues can be discussed. So organizations like UNESCO, for example, for culture and education and arts are also universally practiced and challenged and accepted as well. So all of these things interchange with each other. One of the dangers of globalization, of course, which falls within the framework of the fight against terrorism, is the universal use of the internet that the terrorists have so skillfully utilized in the past 10 years to promote their ideology and their activities and so on. So all of us also have to be quite careful about the negative aspects of globalization. I'm glad to tell you that 3 months ago we received instructions from the Foreign Ministry to issue tourist visas. So if you'd like, I can apply to the embassy anytime. Any of you can apply. Going to Saudi Arabia is something that I urge everybody, and not just congressional representatives. And I hope that you will take me up on that. And where to go to learn most about Saudi Arabia, if you like, is come to Saudi Arabia. please do, and hopefully we can work with you through the embassy to set up programs for you to visit. And as you grew up in Saudi Arabia, you probably know better than others what to do when you get there. But the kingdom is very much looking forward to opening up itself to the world community and receiving tourists. As you know, on a yearly basis, we receive about 12 million tourists in Saudi Arabia. But they are all religious tourists. They come for performance of their religious duties in the holy cities of Mecca and Medina. So the practice of receiving others and hosting them and providing services for them is a long-established practice in the kingdom, going to perhaps even pre-biblical times. And so take me up on what I told them. Come and see us. The embassy will be more than happy to work with you.
My name is Adam Wilhite. I'm from California. And regarding Iran and the development of a nuclear weapon, I hear about possible war in the next few years and escalating conditions or relations between the U.S. and Iran. And my question is, what impact would a war have, and how else might it be resolved peacefully?
Your question is important because it takes a lot of time and thinking, not just on my part, but many people in my government and my country. Saudi Arabia is of the view that any military conflict is detrimental, and any resort to arms is harmful. And hence, in any way we can avoid the use of arms for any specific purpose, we would prefer that. On the issue of nuclear proliferation, the kingdom for the past 20 years has had a motion tabled before the United Nations General Assembly and the United Nations Security Council, which is to consider the area of the Middle East free of weapons of mass destruction. And we would like the Security Council to come out and declare our part of the world an area free of weapons of mass destruction. And we think that if the United States and the other members of the Security Council can come along and accept that, that will go a long way, not only to prevent countries like Iran or Israel or Saudi Arabia or Iraq or Turkey or whatever from acquiring nuclear weapons, but it would also, if you like, remove any stigma of double standard or unfairness in treatment as is used by those who would like to promote either the acquisition of weapons of mass destruction or simply the acquisition of a nuclear weapon. As you know, the Iranians, when we talk to them, they assure us that all they want is simply to have the know-how that is allowed them under the Non-Proliferation Treaty to enrich uranium. We tell them, well, if that is all your objective, then you're going about it the wrong way. And you're raising suspicions by the fact that you kept many of your nuclear installations secret for many years and not open to inspection. So join us in calling for the Middle East free of weapons of mass destruction. And I think we've expressed quite clearly to your officials here that any country in the area acquiring nuclear weapons we consider to be a nightmarish situation. But the use of arms to prevent any country from acquiring nuclear weapons is equally nightmarish. The consequences of that would be catastrophic. And so the third way is to go through this procedure through the diplomatic route. And your country has espoused that route, and President Bush and Secretary Rice have expressed many times that they are going to pursue this issue through the United Nations Security Council, which is a very reassuring matter for us. And hopefully Iran will come along and meet the concerns, not just of the United States, because now it is a worldwide concern. And we've just seen even China and Russia joining in resolutions at the Security Council, sanctions against Iran on that specific issue. And you have to take it step by step. Any use of arms to prevent any country in the area from acquiring nuclear weapons, we think will be a bad way to go.
Sort of in follow-up to that which you just discussed regarding the Saudi relationship with Israel. I know that you yourself met with some Israeli intelligence officials, I understand. My question is this, could you just please expand upon the Saudi-Israeli relationship, specifically in coordinating policy to curb or counter Iran's growing influence in the region?
We have to do to clear make clear to you that I have not met with any Saudi Israeli intelligence officials, nor has any other Saudi official, and official statements have come out from my government to that extent. I was asked, remember, at university in the Eastern Seacoast here. I was giving a speech there, and there was professor, I suspect he might have had Israeli background, but he was an American professor, who asked me why Saudi Arabia doesn't talk to Israel. And I told him that is a legitimate question. And I said, 1981, the late King Fahd came forward with a peace proposal that for the first time, and you must think this is 25 years ago, recognized the existence of the State of Israel in the area. And it was called the Fahd Plan. It was made up of 8 points, the last point of which was the recognition of Israel as being part of the Middle East. And all of the Arab countries were signed up on that proposal. But there was absolutely no response from Israel. Nothing happened from there. In 2002, King Abdullah, when he was Crown Prince, proposed the Abdullah Peace Plan, which, as I said, proposes that Israel withdraw completely from occupied Arab territories, including Jerusalem, in return for complete diplomatic and normalization of relations with Israel. And not only was there no response from Israel, but some Israeli government officials at the time actually considered that, between quotation marks, the most dangerous proposition for Israel to accept. And so there has been no response from Israel. Lately, Ehud Olmert came out with a statement that said that there were some elements in the Abdullah Peace Plan that may be acceptable, or they will have to look into something like that. But that is the reason why we don't talk to Israel. We've been coming forward with propositions and extending our hands in peace, and they have simply refused to reciprocate. We don't talk to them. But as I said in my talk and subsequently, in one of the answers, the need to resolve the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is an imperative. It is not a choice. And for us in the Arab world, more particularly for the Palestinian people who are under the occupation of the Israeli forces, that need is even more imperative than it is for a Saudi or an Egyptian or a Jordanian. And this is how we look upon the situation, and that's why we urge the United States to be forthcoming in taking the lead in finding a solution to this sticking problem.
We have time for one more question. There's a good reason the bell will ring and another class will be coming in. So we'll take one last question.
My name is Mark Patterson, and I'm studying relations studies in political science.
of BYU, and as I'm sure you can agree, sort of the war on terror is essentially a war of ideas. And one way to measure those ideas is the education within a given country. And I first and foremost say that I think the United States has undergone a great education since 9/11. Learned about Islam, and I recognize that many people in the United States have somewhat intolerant views, but as we become more educated. However, in my studies, I've become a little troubled by some of the material I've read and translated Saudi textbooks. One I'd like to quote instructs fourth grade students essentially to hate Christians, Jews, polytheists, and other unbelievers. And then another, that's the Monotheism Jurisprudence. It's a fourth grade textbook made by the Ministry of Education. Another textbook says, and I quote, "The Jews and Christians are enemies of the believers and they cannot approve of Muslims." And it goes on in another textbook to define jihad as wrestling with the infidels by calling them to the faith and battling against them. And of course, the word battle is qital, which of course comes from the root qatl, to kill. So it clearly has a military implication. My question to you is, how can we build tolerance with the Saudi society and the culture of Saudi Arabia? How can we build tolerance when it appears that this type of information and ideas are being taught in Saudi public schools?
That's a very good question, and I think the operative word in your question is appears. And we in Saudi Arabia have recognized that there are shortcomings in our textbooks. And in the way that we teach, not just religion, but other subjects, whether it's science, mathematics, or whatever. And hence, for the last five years, we've been undergoing a tremendous review of all of these matters, including these textbooks that you quote. And I know when I came here in September 2005, I think it was just a couple of months after that, Freedom House came out with a report. You may be quoting from that report on that issue. So what I did was to get in touch with the board of the Freedom House and invite them to come and talk with us at the embassy and see where we can work together to improve textbooks in Saudi Arabia, so that all this intolerant and unacceptable language can be totally eradicated from all of the textbooks in Saudi Arabia. There is a Saudi Islamic Academy in Virginia, near Washington, that has been teaching Saudi students, the children of diplomats, but also it teaches whoever wants to apply to it. And there are some Americans who study there. And I know that if you look at the textbooks there, you will find that all such language has been completely removed from those textbooks. But we recognize that we have this problem, and we're working to eradicate it and to eliminate it. And as a matter of fact, your ambassador who's in charge of such issues has been visiting the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia to review with us the efforts that we're making to remove these hateful words from whatever textbook that is taught in the Kingdom. And his reporting on the Kingdom has been published. Most of it is very positive. It indicates that we are serious and that we are taking steps to take away these unacceptable words. And as you say, Annie, the issue of bigotry and intolerance is not exclusive to or unique to the Kingdom or to the United States. Unfortunately, it's a universal issue. And when you have, even in the United States, respected preachers of Christian sects who come out and say hateful words about the Prophet Muhammad and the religion of Islam, that is equally unacceptable. And what I asked from Freedom House, when I met with them, is that they be equally active in monitoring and making people aware of the hateful material that comes out from here as well about Islam, about the Prophet of of Islam. It is something we all have to work together with. And all societies have faced at one time or another such intolerance and bigotry. But it is not enough simply to be condemnatory about these issues. You really have to sit down and work towards removing whatever language or teaching material that is taught either in Saudi schools or in other academic or religiously based teaching institutions. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.